Welcome to the Women in Vinyl podcast with Jen DiEugenio, founder of Women in Vinyl and contributor Robyn Raymond. This podcast facilitates conversations with those working in the vinyl record industry to educate, demystify, and diversify the vinyl community.
Tuning in to episode 23 of the Women in Vinyl podcast. You just heard Come Out and Play by Stereophonic Space Sound Unlimited off their record The Flawless Miss Drake, out February 25th via High Tide Recordings. High Tide will be our musical partner for the next few episodes. They are an international record label and lifestyle brand, a duo of vinyl DJs and women co-owned, sharing surf, lounge, and exotic sounds. Check the show notes for more on them and where to buy this record. Today, we're rejoined by mastering engineer at the bakery and board member, the talented Jett Galindo. We recently did a discussion for our friends at Sound Girls about an indie artist's guide to releasing physical media, and we wanted to take the time to have that discussion here for you all. This will be part of a little series on the topic, so we hope you enjoy. Hey, Jett, thanks for joining us again.
Hey! I'm always here for Women in Vinyl. Glad to be back.
So I mentioned in the intro that we did this conversation for Sound Girls, but it would be really great for our listeners. And so we're going to do a little series where we'll expand with various guests on some of the things that we talk about today. But how to release physical media for an indie artist. Who wants to take it away?
Well, before we dive in, the reason why we decided that this would be a really good episode is because there's so much information out there, and sometimes it's fragmented that it kind of becomes a bit overwhelming for your everyday indie artist to want to get started on how to release on vinyl, you know? And it's like there's so much like distorted sources of information out there that it's so hard to navigate. And there's a lot of like, do this, don't do that. Mm-hmm. And especially with indie artists that are on a tight schedule and tight budget, we're going to do our best to shed some light on all the information that will help you get started and options that are accessible to you and your budget. So that's going to be what we'll aim for today. Just to help you get started as an indie artist on jumping on this physical format release.
Yeah, primer on releasing your music in a tangible format.
And so, Robyn, why should someone release their music on vinyl?
We prefer the vinyl format for a variety of reasons, not only because the jacket is way easier on your eyeballs to see than a teeny tiny little screen on your iPhone, but also because it gives you a moment with your artist. It gives you a tiny piece of their soul that they have put into plastic for all of the rest of time. It's a physical thing that exists and takes up space in the world. It's not just a disposable in the background kind of thing anymore that is streaming and all of those things. It just becomes such a special piece of an artist, I think. Mm-hmm. And that's the beauty of doing records.
Yeah, exactly. Back in normal times when people could come to the plant or pick up their records, you know, it's always so much fun to see how excited they are.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And how much space they take up in their car.
and just to add to that too, especially nowadays that our normal, like our regular way of consuming music is through streaming, and that's mm-hmm. also how we discover music. Yeah. But the fact of the matter is, any streaming platform will not give you the privilege of owning the music.
That's
so
exactly
you
it.
Do get the perk of listening and discovering so much music out there, but once it's time to own the music, vinyl is such a rewarding way to do it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, nobody can take your tunes away, man.
Mm-hmm. And when you can't tour, you know, I get people that reach out a lot that ask for me to listen to their record. I hate the word influencer, but, you know, I think that sharing your music that way too, where you can give somebody a tangible, beautiful piece mm-hmm. of your thing that if they enjoy and they share it with other people, then it continues to expand your audience.
Totally.
So there's that aspect too. You can't really do that. I mean, you can send someone a download code, but how's that for shareable content? So what are some caveats to releasing your music on vinyl?
Caveats. So now we go down to like the reality of the format. And this is sometimes one of the things that your typical indie artist will not be aware of at the very beginning. And usually once you start hearing about all these caveats, it starts kind of like discouraging you from like going down the route of vinyl. And so we're going to talk about them now with the hopes that it doesn't intimidate you. And it's all completely doable as an indie artist to proceed with vinyl. So the first thing you have to be aware of with the vinyl format is the longer manufacturing timeline. If you'd ever decide to release your music on vinyl, don't just set 1 month of turnaround time. If you speak to any vinyl manufacturing plant or mastering engineer, they will tell you right then and there that you will need at least, on a regular scenario, at least 3 to 6 months. However, we're living in times where a lot of shipping delays are going on and many other things are causing some backups in many facets of the production line. So now the average timeline for vinyl manufacturing is 1 year. So keep that in mind and don't let that discourage you from going down the vinyl route, because many artists, record label or indie, have taken advantage of that timeline by releasing their vinyl as like a special edition or just an additional way to drum up the promotion on your music. So just keep in mind the timeline right now. Then the other thing you have to keep in mind is there's a higher upfront cost compared to other formats. So that's one thing you really need to be prepared for when you're going down the vinyl route, is to just research all the costs that go through every stage of the production. And we're going to go through them later. And then the final thing, just one of the things we're going to cover now, I mean, there's more, but the one thing that is also important to know when you're releasing on vinyl is to at least make an effort to educate your audience about the format. We were talking about this on the panel last time, but when Taylor Swift came out with special edition vinyl record that was 45 RPM, it wasn't clearly listed on the vinyl record. So a lot of the audience, when they started to play the vinyl record, not knowing that it was 45 RPM, they played it at 33. And now they thought that they're listening to a man the whole time because of the slower speed. And there were a lot of like reviews that were complaining about, why is there a dude on the Taylor Swift album the whole time?
So, it's still my favorite thing of 2021 and it always will be.
Yeah, there will be unique things about the vinyl format that you need to make sure your audience is aware of. So like speed, even the whole proper care and maintenance of the vinyl record. Like there's a lot of younger vinyl listeners that don't realize that leaving your vinyl record in the car would cause it to warp. So things right. like that. So make an effort to, when you release your music on vinyl, it is for life. Like it lasts for a lifetime if it's properly cared for. Yeah. So that's just a few of the caveats.
Yeah. And I think to kind of jump on to some of those, the longer manufacturing timeline, I just want to mm-hmm. mention for anybody that is doing a pressed vinyl release, not to wait until you have everything done at this point to submit. So it would be best if you're thinking about it or you're in the mastering stage to start contacting plants and see who has the kind of packages and turn times that you are okay with right now, and then get your test pressing order started once you have that mastered for vinyl audio, because that's going to take you, you know, at least a month, if not longer, depending on plating, turn times, and everything. And then for upfront costs, like different plants work in different ways. So some people take half upfront, some will take test pressing deposits, and then your finished goods afterwards. But you'll want to sort of ask those questions too to know what you need going in. Because your project, you know, for a single record, you might be looking at, you know, $800 or so for your test pressings. And then like a couple thousand, depending on your package, for your finished goods. And then you have to consider shipping too, because shipping to a residential address, depending on where you're located, could be $500, $1,000. So those are all really important things to consider. Like shipping to a business would be less, you know, than shipping to a resident. So those are all things that are going to be part of that process that you need to consider when you're asking those things up front. But yeah, and so the delays, you know, we have talked about this before. We did our State of the Industry talk with Katie Clove.
Heck yeah.
And then the episode with Billy really outlines a lot of these things, but just some quick bullet point reminders. The availability and shortages of raw materials. So because people were home and doing home improvements, that PVC that they're using for flooring is the same kind of PVC as we use for records.
That's right.
Ours just needs to be cleaned a little bit more and processed a little bit better. So those raw materials are getting harder and harder to get. Some of the colors are in shorter supply, like clear for a while has been no ETA on when we'll get more.
Interesting.
Yeah. And so everybody is ordering from a handful of PVC suppliers, just like lacquers and everything else within this industry. There aren't just anybody to pick and choose from.
No.
So if some of those manufacturers, which is the case, are overseas, then there are shipping delays as well, because as everybody knows, we can't travel as freely as we would like. And so those flights are fewer and far between. So when ships are getting stuck, that may have some of your PVC on it that will delay how things get to you. And those are all real things that we cannot control. There's nothing we can do. Port strikes, port closures, Brexit. I mean, there's just so many things that people are up against in trying to get the records delivered. And then of course, just COVID as a whole. So yeah, I mean, those are some talking points, and really go back and listen to those episodes for a really more in-depth overview. So talking about a couple options with vinyl pressing before we get into lathe cuts. So one option is to go to your pressing plant directly, which is a more cost-effective option typically, but you will need to be more hands-on with your project, especially now, like if the pressing plant gives you certain dates, those dates are crucial to you hitting when you need to turn in audio, approve things, send in art, all of that. But it does cut out any middleman, and you have most control over your final output, because you can pick and choose things that you want as far as plating, packaging, and really decide what fits with your end goal and marketing plan. Also, if there is any bad news that needs to be shared as far as delays or colors or issues, you hear about that first, so there's no delay in that coming from someone else.
It's kind of quicker that way.
Yeah, for sure. So some examples of some great plants. I mean, we could go on forever, but
there's a lot. And also keep in mind too that no matter what location you are in, don't limit yourself to the quote unquote nearest pressing plant to where you're located, because all these pressing plants work worldwide. So we've heard of artists that go to a plant in Czech Republic to get their vinyl records pressed on a budget. But there's so many amazing pressing plants here in the US that are very accommodating and friendly to indie artists releasing on their own.
Don't get discouraged.
Yeah, a huge misconception is that every single pressing plant in the entire world is in the pocket of the majors. And that I think that's one of the biggest things that I would like to dispel, is that not every single pressing plant is going to be at capacity with major label stuff. So there are, sometimes there is room to plunk things in schedules. And that's one of the other reasons that it's beneficial to talk to somebody at the actual pressing plant, because if you have a relationship with that customer service representative, then they're able to be like, oh no, I do. Oh, okay. We can move this around and they have all their stuff in. So I might be able to get them on press here because this job's delayed and blah, blah, blah. You have an advocate, somebody at the actual location doing the thing that knows the thing.
Exactly.
That might be able to, you know, make things work for you.
So I mentioned a broker. And so a broker works as the person who is essentially between you and the plant. So you're going to give them your ideas for what you want, and then they're going to use their resources through all of the different plants. Sometimes they don't print through the pressing plant. Sometimes they have their own printers that they supply print. So they're able to pick and choose the best options for your release. Again, this is helpful if you have no experience doing vinyl. However, you are sort of at... you don't necessarily, yeah, because you don't actually know necessarily who's pressing it, or you don't have a say in, you know, certain quality standards potentially. So it just sort of depends what you feel most comfortable with. If you really want someone to take charge and handle it for you, then you may want to look into a broker. And a few examples of those are like Pirates Press, Crates, Groove House, Bandcamp. Is disc doing makers. A similar, yeah, disc makers. So there are a lot of options out there for them as well.
Also, to add to that too, many times when you do your research, a lot of vinyl brokers don't always mention that they're brokers. Like, there's a misconception for a while that Pirates Press is a pressing plant because they're called Pirates Press, but it's they're a broker. They work with a pressing plant in the Czech Republic, and Pirates Press is located in the Bay Area. But at the end of the day, it helps that you're listening to the Women in Vinyl podcast to learn as much as you could about the whole world of vinyl production. And if you just do a quick research, go to their website, it's easy to know when a service is either a broker or an actual pressing plant.
Right. And, you know, we don't want to tell you one option is better than the other. Yeah. I think it depends what is best for you and your release and how involved you want to be. And just knowing what the differences are is really the most important part.
Exactly.
And sometimes financing too, because I will say one of the great aspects of Crates is that they kind of work in like a little bit of a Kickstarter crowdfund situation where you can actually like put it on sale. And as long as you've got enough like backers or buyers, your order will go through. And then that way you actually don't have to front load all of the money.
Yeah,
you can defer your money like right onto your end customer, because you're just like, hey, if you don't pay for it, you're not getting it. So there you go.
I think so Dicker's Factory too.
Yeah, exactly. And that's the thing. It's like, you know, you don't have to choose your first option all of the time. You know, like there's a lot of considerations to go into releasing physical format. So, I mean, don't decide on, you know, give yourself some time after you've done some research to be able to pick your best option.
Yeah. Just to add to that too, I think it's a good way to summarize that. In a way, going the broker route, it's kind of like an easy entry to the whole world, especially if you don't know much. But then I know a lot of people who started working with a broker, but then for their second release, they know much more and they feel much more in control with the whole process and want more control. And at that point, it's actually exciting to go the whole, go directly to the pressing plant and engineer route.
100%. Totally. Yeah. I think the other thing to consider, and this is probably a good segue into lathe cuts, is what your quantity is and, you know, where that fits. A lot of pressing plants will have a 300 piece minimum. Now it's in some cases getting bumped up to 500 or 1,000 just because of the downtime for machines really slows down production. So if you have to put a 300, 200 piece order on, that changeover from one machine to the other, from stampers to emptying a hopper, will really delay production time. So if you start to see those rising, and depending on the quantity you need, then a lathe cut could be a good option. However, Robyn will talk to you about minimums or maximums, I guess.
Yes.
I love what I do. I love cutting records. But the one thing that I'll say is that this turnaround time extension in pressing plants is starting to become my own personal nightmare, because people are saying, oh, well, we'll just get somebody to do lathe cuts for it. So I keep getting asked to do 200, 250, 300 records. And I will do that. But my caveat is you have to understand that a pressing plant will do 100 in 45 minutes. I will take 40 to 45 hours to do 100. And so don't come back at me and tell me that my prices are too high when it's going to take me 10 times as long to do your records.
They probably don't realize either. And I think it's important to mention again that you're cutting those in real time.
And that's one disc at a time.
Right. So while we can just put some stampers in and it runs through a cycle, granted, we have to check it, QC it, make sure it's good.
Yeah.
But you have to do that and listen to it over and over and over again.
Yeah. And that's the thing. I do listen to it in real time, one by one. If there's an error,
Robyn memorizes the music.
Yeah. and that's the thing. It's like, I'm happy to do 100 records for you if that's what you want, but you have to understand that you can't put pressing plant prices onto a lathe cut person because we're not robots. And so we can't do the kind of quantity that you're expecting in the same amount of time.
Well, materials and labor always equal a difference in cost, no matter what we're talking about, whether it's
no matter what option,
no matter what.
Yeah. And that's exactly it. So we're going to evaluate lathe cuts versus lathe cuts, not lathe cuts versus pressing plants.
Yeah. And we're going to have another great episode, which we'll keep the guest a secret for now, but we will talk all about lathe cuts and the cool things you can do.
Yeah.
Yeah. So if someone is looking to prepare their music for vinyl, because a lot of first-time clients don't know to master for vinyl, what should they think about, Jett?
Sure. So now that an artist decides that they want to release their music on vinyl, I think the main question is that, do they have to do things differently? Should I do anything different production-wise if I'm releasing my music on vinyl? So as a mastering engineer, my answer is not technically. It's quite common that artists, whether even record labels, just deliver the standard digital wave files of your music to us cutting engineers and pressing plants, and your record will still be pressed into vinyl. But there are several factors to be mindful of, because remember, the vinyl format is an old medium and it's been around for decades. So it's been around. And at the same time, although there are innovations in the format has remained the same for decades. So the format has kept its essence is the same way, but music keeps evolving. So there's going to be music that will play nice with the format, and there will be others that you will need extra work in terms of just making sure that it translates as good as it could on the format. And here are a few things to be mindful of. Number one, the sibilance in your music will affect the quality of your vinyl record. So just the whole nature of the format itself, the high energy of your high frequency sibilants, the S, the T's on your music, the whole physics behind cutting of the stylus and cutting that high frequency energy into the vinyl record, your playback stylus just can't physically keep up with tracing the groove if there's too much energy on that frequency. So it tends to happen a lot with like a lot of like standard vocal records where the vocals are too upfront. I remember we cut Diana Krall and there's just a lot of like S, and that was a production choice. But with the vinyl format, you have to keep that in mind. And then it happens a lot with pop records too. Like a lot of our modern day pop music gets harder and harder to cut into vinyl just because of that high frequency energy on the sibilant. So keep that in mind, especially if you know you're releasing your music on vinyl. Just be mindful.
Yeah, and I just want to say really quick here that is something that we cannot fix on your test pressings.
Yes.
That is in your audio. So you have to think about it from, like, really work with your mastering engineer on what the end goal is, because we get a lot of times where people will be like, the left channel is X, Y, and Z, or this, you know, sound, like talking about sibilance and things like that. And we cannot do anything. We are making a copy. So,
yeah.
And that might be one of the best, I guess, segues back into the production chain, is actually, like, before you get into even talking about cutting, like making vinyl, like find a mastering engineer that has made records that you like
and is familiar
and is familiar with the, like, the kind of music that you do, and like ask them, especially if they're a lacquer cutter or a DMM cutter, like, or they've actually like had successful records cut from their mastering. Just be like, hey, like, is this going to be a problem? Is this going to be problematic? Or like, how would this sound on vinyl? Or could you do a vinyl pre-master? Like, just even questions like that, and having that relationship with a mastering engineer where they will actually give you brass tacks.
Do you have a lot of those conversations, Jett?
Yeah. In fact, that's one of the main good reasons why it's good to connect directly with the pressing plant and your cutting engineer, because you won't have this opportunity to communicate with the lacquer cutter if you go through a broker. That's just right. one of the few things to keep in mind. But I do have these conversations sometimes with clients. In fact, it's funny. There are times that I mastered the vinyl that I also cut, and I recently did this electronic record. And what I like to do is, when the clients attend a mastering session, I cut like one song on the house for them to take home so they can listen to it. And of course, it's electronic. So like, as soon as I cut a record, I already did a lot of like the pre-settings. I haven't really pre-mastered for the vinyl format yet, because I was mastering at that point. But yeah, it's like, it just, the needle just kept jumping off, because, but I am going to go to that. Like, that's one of the things that you also have to keep in mind. After sibilance, the next thing that you have to be mindful of is your low frequency stereo imaging in your music. It. And that doesn't mean that you should mono your music. Yeah. Please do not. And I will go into a bit more detail. We have on the show notes, we went into more detail in a previous episode. The low frequency stereo imaging, any low frequency stereo effects where you, for example, like hard panning, like a kick drum or something, or hard panning bass guitar, or there's like a synth that has a very stereo effect that goes on. So it happens a lot in electronic music. I went into more detail on that on the previous episode, but what essentially happens is the grooves end up becoming very thick and then thin. Too thin to a point that the groove might even disappear. And that is considered a reject when you're cutting, because you don't want your needle to jump. So that doesn't mean that you should mono your low end. Please don't. And a lot of articles there are saying that this is a problem, but that also doesn't mean that if you're producing or you're mixing or you work with a mastering engineer, the solution is to not mono your music. Please don't prevent this fact about the format to stop you from your creativity when you make music. It's more about just being aware, and there might be like some stereo effect that happens that's not intentional to the music. So it's good to keep that in mind as you keep producing. And then also know that your lacquer cutters and lathe cutters have tools to combat that low frequency stereo effects from avoiding a good cut. So we have tools to combat that. So we're able to control that, but it helps us and it makes us a happy engineer if those are kept in mind beforehand. Now, I actually wrote an article for iZotope that goes into detail explaining why that happens. And I'll ask Jen and Robyn to add that on the show notes. In fact, iZotope said that it's like one of their more popular articles. So I actually did a rewrite of that to include listening examples. So Jen was talking about how the sound of distortion is not something they can fix. I have audio examples of how your music sounds with bad sibilance on a vinyl record, so you're aware. I also have like a listening example of your needle jumping because of that low frequency effect. So we'll make sure to share that once that listening examples are available. So those are the two main things that will be your Achilles heel on vinyl. But there are additional things that are also helpful to keep in mind, and it's easier to do on your end as an indie artist. Number one is your track order. And Robin's going to agree with this. So it's very important to be strategic about your album sequence when you know you're going to vinyl, because the reality of the format is the very innermost diameter on your record, the one that's closest to the label, will always be lower in quality compared to the rest of the disc, just because of the physical reality of the format, where the innermost diameter doesn't translate the high frequency grooves as accurately as in other areas in your vinyl record surface. And the article that I wrote goes into more detail on that. So you want your album sequence to make sure that your high energy, loud records are farther from the inner diameter. Yeah, so
beginning of the side.
Yeah, you want it to be at the beginning of the side. So like your side B will have like your other energetic records at the very start of side B. And then you want your chill, like less loud, more relaxed songs to be at the end of each side, because those songs are the least affected.
And as a sidebar to that, I'm also going to say the side lengths, because
yes.
The number of times that people are like, oh yeah, so the runtime of the record is 55 minutes. And I'm like,
God,
oh yeah.
No.
So what four songs are we cutting out of this record?
Yeah.
Because there's only a certain amount of time and actual space on a record, a lacquer, a DMM, that we can transpose your music onto. So generally, and Jett, correct me if I'm wrong in lacquer land, but it's about 20 minutes aside.
Mm-hmm. 18 to 20
minutes. That's correct. Yeah. 18 to 20 minutes is the happy medium. But also it's also a bit genre dependent. Like the very heavy, hard-hitting genres like rock, electronic, try not to go over 20 minutes.
Yeah.
Because like the longer your music is, the farther it goes into the inner diameter of this of your disc. So the low frequencies also take up the most width on your groove. So you just want to be mindful that your hard-hitting genres, try to keep it at a maximum 20, but you're going to make your cutter happy if you're at 18 minutes, 16 minutes even.
I know I have this conversation with people a lot when they're trying to fit more than that on a side. Maybe you could explain what that entails for you cutting if it has to be longer, and what the like drop in EQ, for example, might mean to someone if they do push over that.
So it happens. It happens quite often that we deal with longer sides. Like we have cut 30 minute sides and it hurts our heart. So when you have a long side, the thing that ends up getting sacrificed and compromised, first of all, is your level. We can cut more, we can fit more music, longer sides, by bringing down the level of your music.
That's right.
It's kind of like not the ideal solution too, because you're kind of like going closer towards the surface noise of your record. So you're going to be dealing with a lot more problems with signal to noise ratio. Mm-hmm. And a lot of cheap pressing plants and those that don't care much about quality, the easiest way to avoid any problems with sibilance and low frequency groove skips is just bringing the volume down. Because by bringing the volume down, you don't worry about those at all. However, your music is the suffers. One that's going to be taking the hit.
When you put it on the turntable and you have to turn up, you're like, why is it so low when I put it on?
Yeah,
like,
and why do I hear a lot of like just needle scratches and surface noise? So like at the end of the day, we understand that not all people really care about like having the most perfect sounding record. They just want their record out, and we totally understand. So when you are on a tight budget, you can get your record out, but know that it's often the music that will get compromised if you really limit your budget and cut corners. Mm-hmm. So those are the things that is helpful to keep in mind. Again, you don't really have to, like, essentially, you can't submit your actual music, but know that if your music is highly sibilant and there's a lot of, like, stereo imaging, if you don't take care of that beforehand, your music will be at the mercy of the lacquer cutter. Yeah. So depending on the cost that you put into the cutting of the lacquer or the lathe, that engineer will have tools to do as much as they could to restore as much of your musical content. But then there will be cases where they're just going to turn the volume of that down just so it works and no test cuts needed. So those are the things to keep in mind.
I'm going to say that's another little caveat too, is mm-hmm. that test pressings should never be evaluated against digital.
Yes. Yes.
Because thanks for the way that records play back, and it's very common now that even people that are getting records don't have record players. So you give them a test press and they're like, oh, well, I don't know where to play this, you know? So understanding the medium, again, is one of the biggest things about getting records. Yes, mm-hmm. records are sexy. We love them. They're super sexy. They're shiny. They're soft. They're beautiful. But understanding that how a record plays back and what your music is going to sound like on a record is not going to be the same as digital.
Right. Yes.
If your expectation is that it's going to sound like your digital files, you are wrong. Mm-hmm. So that's like one of the biggest things too, I think is a caveat, is that just to make everybody's life in production a little bit easier too. So, because yes, there are things that you need to maybe compromise on to create a perfect physic capability of a record to be able to contain your music. It's not going to sound the same as your streaming masters. It's going to sound the same as those digital files.
Yeah, that's important, especially if you're a first time releasing your music on vinyl.
Yeah.
Manage your expectations. Yeah. And surface noise is the reality of your vinyl record. Yeah. Don't expect it to be quiet like a digital record. And vinyl format is loved for decades because of that. That's the sound of vinyl. So I'm glad that Robyn remembered to bring that up. Vinyl will not be sounding similar as your digital.
Yeah, we try. I mean, we try and make it sound as quiet and beautiful as we can. But again, it's mm-hmm. just like those weird little things that make it quirky, you know, that we all love so much. But
so there are a few other additional little tips that we can give to you when you know you're releasing your music on vinyl. So besides those sonic adjustments and ways to optimize the sound of your music, there are a couple of things on the production side that will help you get to your vinyl product faster. Number one, decide on a catalog/scribe number ahead of time. So when you work with a vinyl, either a broker or a pressing plant, they will ask for a catalog or scribe number. And a lot of people get kind of like confused. Oh shit, what is that? I don't have that. But it's in your head. You just have to decide. It's like any string of alphanumeric characters. And it doesn't have to be long.
Yeah, so like if your label was Women in Vinyl, it could be like WIV100.
Exactly. And you need that because throughout the production line, that is essentially the only thing that will help identify your disc. Because you'll know there's no label as you go through the whole production line when we make your vinyl record. It's just going to be your music grooves and then that scribe number that gets etched literally onto your disc. So we need that as soon as possible. Don't even wait. And there are times when we are actually cutting the lacquer master and we still don't know the scribe number. It does cause delays on the production line.
Yeah, it can be confusing if we like order stampers or something and it has a different catalog number because the client decided later you cut something different. Like, yeah, it can be confusing to match them up.
So first thing. Next, and Jen will agree to this. Deliver your master for cutting as early as possible.
Yes.
So remember, our current turnaround time is about like 1 year at this point because of the delays and the pandemic and all that. So as soon as you have your master approved, don't even delay. While you're mixing your music or while your mastering engineer is mastering the music, already start shopping around for the pressing plant. Do your music while you're like writing your music. So do your research. So by the time it's there, you can just press the green light, hit the button, deliver. And right. That's going to speed up the production line. And finally, this might be something a lot of indie artists might not be familiar with. You can actually deliver a fully assembled side A wave file and side B wave file rather than individual tracks. And in a way, one of the good things about that is it lessens the margin of error when the cutter is cutting your record. Because there are cases, and this has happened, when we receive individual tracks, there might be the mistake of a sequence problem. If you assemble it on your own and you export it as one solid wave file for side A and side B, that eliminates that issue. But when you do that, make sure to include a text file or something to make sure that your cutter knows which time in the music the next song starts, so we're able to mark it down on your vinyl record. So that's one of a few things that we suggest will help make the whole process much smoother for you as the indie artist.
Hold that thought. It's time for an Amanda fact.
So the first flat recorded sound discs were created by a guy named Emil Berliner in 1887. He also created the process for electroplating, stamping out mass-produced copies from a mother. And in 1893, his U.S. gramophone company began the sales of mass-produced flat disc recordings for home entertainment purposes. Berliner discs are actually composed of vulcanized rubber, not the same components that you find in what we think of as shellac discs or vinyl today. And the masters were etched zinc.
Have you received your teal box in the mail? No, not jewelry, your high-fidelity Eargasm earplugs. Eargasm high-fidelity earplugs keep your hearing protected in style. But they also recognize that their products aren't only for hearing protection and are widely used for people's mental health and well-being in noisy situations. How do these help you in your daily life? From noise sensitivity, overstimulation, or ear protection, they're the brand for you. Eargasm has a great deal with 10% off your order using, you guessed it, discount code WOMENINVINYL at checkout. www.eargasm.com. And now, back to the episode. So I think the last little bit to cover here is probably, so you get your records that you've spent your time and money on.
Yeah.
What are some suggestions on selling them? Distributing them?
Yeah, well, there's all the wonderful distro options. I mean, we all love Bandcamp. There's opportunities for you to go down to your friendly neighborhood record store and talk to your super best buddies that run the record store and do a consignment situation where you're like, hey, I'm a local band and you love me, sell my records for me and you can keep a portion of the action. And I mean, that's always a fun time. There's that way to do it. I mean, Jen, how do you like to get independent records? Check out your labels.
Yeah, I mean, you could definitely approach distributors. Some distributors will take on artists. Record stores, I really think, are a strong avenue besides Bandcamp, because so many record stores have that local section. Mm-hmm. So, I definitely think that is a good option. Also, merch and web stores are another
way. And also, just to add to that, too, if you guys go to the Women in Vinyl website, Jen has done a great job of getting information of all the record stores here in the US. and there will be an awesome record store in your area. So definitely connect with them. And also, I agree with what Robyn was saying about how if you're releasing vinyl, to have an exclusive kind of version of your vinyl record when you're touring. Like I know I worked with this electronic producer that has different variants of his vinyl record, and they all look cool. And certain variants are only available when you go to his live show. So that's a great way to encourage like interactivity and just support from your fan base. But yeah, I'm a big fan of Bandcamp too. And yeah, kind of similar to like going back to crates. There's a lot of online platforms that give you like unconventional ways to sell and raise funds for your vinyl record. Like with crates, they do a crowdfunding situation. And I know that Bandcamp is like getting into that crowdfunding for vinyl too. I might be wrong, but yeah, just stay up to date and go keep researching online, because there's more and more unconventional new methods of releasing vinyl, and hell, even in by being part of vinyl communities online. Like I know that there's a very big vinyl community for video game music collectors, and just that community alone, there's so much people that just spreading the word on vinyl records and just people like trading vinyl records. So yeah, there's a lot of community-based selling and support that happens.
Yeah, and I will say one thing that if you can't do variants just because of cost or limitations in minimums, because again, they're like that's machine downtime. So where we used to be able to switch over for 100 pieces or 200 pieces or whatever, some other things you could think about would be like signed copies. Like maybe you could get them, like just get some delivered in poly bags and then sign those. Or you could get a special insert or like art print that go in those exclusives.
Yeah, good idea.
Like those kinds of things are really great add-ons that won't cost you too much, but also make it special.
Totally. You know, it's like maybe your digital release has extra songs because you had to cut them to be able to have appropriate side links. So, you know, you're like, oh, I'm going to drop a track a week until you get the full album. Or, you know, maybe
That's always a really great idea, Robyn. Yeah, like I recommend that to people when they have long sides.
Totally.
And then even though not everybody uses download cards, like you could put a download card with those extra tracks too.
Yeah. Bandcamp offers up to 1,000 cards for free for downloads. So, you know, like you don't even have to pay for those. I mean, you know, you could, there's, you know, maybe you do a live stream or something and maybe you give away a free record or something. Like there's so many, like it's, there's so many people trying to do the same thing as you. You need to find a way to stand out. So, you know, like being armed in all of these ways and understanding all of your options and understanding everything as completely as possible. Like, you know, there's ways to do a really great vinyl release that will, you know, get your investment back, keep your fan base excited and grow your audience.
And also just to add to that too, you can't even just choose one or two songs to put into vinyl.
Yeah, like maybe do a single instead of a full length. Absolutely.
There's a lot of ways to be smart about the budgeting. And also like I don't think we've covered this yet, but I don't know much about this, but maybe you guys do, but like those monthly subscriptions of vinyl records, there's got to be a way for artists to get considered for those too. But yeah, do your research. There's a lot of demand for vinyl. And yeah,
and then I think the last thing just to mention is once you receive your records, if you haven't sold through your whole lot upon receipt, would just be to remember to store them vertically in a cool, dry spot, because some people do sit on records for a long time. We hope that you won't, but if you do, you don't want to pull one out to ship, you know, months later or something, and they're warped from sitting on top of each other. But yeah, so. Well, I think this was a great start to the series.
Thanks, Jett.
Yeah, thank you.
You're welcome. My pleasure.
It's always a pleasure to have you.
Yeah, always. Like, I'm always here for Women in Vinyl, and any way that we can make the whole process of vinyl release easier for the indie artist. We're right there with you guys. You can find more information. Actually, we have uploaded a video of the presentation. Where can people find it? Okay, it's on YouTube. And there's going to be a lot more questions from the attendees there. So we highly recommend checking out that presentation. And yeah, this is pretty much a summary of every episode that women in vinyl have covered. And we hope that this encourages you to release your music on vinyl.
Absolutely.
Make more records.
Yeah.
Thanks for joining us on the Women in Vinyl podcast. You can join our ever-growing list of sponsors, other record labels, Selector, Couple Design, Eargasm, Groove Washer, Glowtronics, New Gen Audio, and bam, announcing Vinyl Revolution Record Show live in your face and in your ears on March 6th. Join the lovely and talented Amanda Schutzman, and thanks for sponsoring the show. Hey, as always, you can join our conversation on Instagram or send us a note at media@womeninvinyl.com. Clock us, send us info. If you have a question, yo, we got the answer, or we'll find it. We won't lie to you. And check out womeninvinyl.com for past episodes, the store, the job board, and the library of resources. Don't forget to like and subscribe and give us a review on your favorite podcast delivery method. You can also contribute to furthering our mission at patreon.com/womeninvinyl. Hey, guess what? This episode, 45 minutes. You know there was more. You want more? You get more. Go to patreon.com and you can get more. And you'll find all the B-sides, the deep cuts, and the amazing extras, including longer episodes, and contribute to the creation of scholarships and educational opportunities to further the demystification, the infiltration of more women and non-binary identifying humans into the vinyl making space, decreasing those turnaround times every week. Yeah, we love your records. We want you to love them too. Womeninvinyl.com.
This episode has been brought to you by Women in Vinyl and Red Spade Records. Thank you for listening. Please remember to subscribe. And you can always contact us directly by visiting www.womeninvinyl.com.